just conclude. Now the message is, as you have heard him, is very loud and clear. You can play all the three roles as a company secretary dealing with the competition law. You can be an in-house advisor dealing right from the preparation of the minutes up to dealing with the situation of the divestment of the assets in the issue of the combination. I need not to repeat that everything has been told to you in no unclear terms. You can play your role, choice is yours. I have to only one small advice to give in that area. Please remember, nowhere in your appointment letter as a company secretary, this role will be written to you. Nobody gives you in writing that what when you take over as a company secretary of a company, that this is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 10 things that you are required to do. The initiative is to be taken by you. You have to come out of your shell and tell the management that what you are capable of doing. You may have so many other traits, but if they are hidden, you are not coming out, you are not letting the management do, you are not taking the initiative, you are not coming forward to take more and more responsibilities, people will think that you are only capable what is on the surface. So let that shell be broken. Take as many responsibilities, show your capabilities, show your skills, show your knowledge, demonstrate that you are capable of doing more than what you have been appointed for. The second part, even as a practicing company secretaries, right from going as a consultant and advisor, you can take the role up to the filing of the forms and even sometimes he says the audit. For example, the unfair agreements audit, the monopolies agreement audit. There could be so many other things that you can innovate and tell the commission that you are ready to help as a practicing company secretary and you can have your role. Even the third one is more important, which he has said that you can join the commission. And I can say with pride that you cannot have a better role model than Mr. Sahu himself. Your own institute CEO and the secretary today is an honorable member of the commission. Now what more you want? What better example you can have that what you are capable of doing? Therefore the initiative is to be taken by you. Now coming to the topic which is very closer to my heart, that other than this law, there is something known as the unfair conduct. I could narrate the jokes after the jokes, but something which has come to me very recently, to my knowledge, this you must enjoy in Hindi rather than in English. I can narrate it to you in English, but I'm sure you will not enjoy because the whole bedrock of this joke is Hindi. So please take it from me in Hindi. I speak in Hindi. You can convert it into Haryanvi later on. Ek housewife bazaar mein gayi. Sabji kharidna chahti thi. Jaake dekha market mein dukandar baitha hua hai, bahut sari sabjiyan uske paas rakhi hui hain. Palak kharidna chahti thi. Jaise hi dukandar ne dekha ki aurat uski taraf ko aa rahi hai aur kuch na kuch sabji khareedegi, उसने बाल्टी में से पानी लिया और पानी छिड़कना शुरू कर दिया. और क्योंकि पालक वैसे हल्का होता है लेकिन अगर उस पर पानी डाल दो तो वो भारी हो जाता है, तो उस औरत को अच्छा नहीं लगा. वो 2 मिनट खड़ी रही कि शायद अब ये बंद हो जाएगा, उसने और पानी छिड़का. फिर वो खड़ी रही, उसने और पानी छिड़का, तो औरत को बहुत गुस्सा आ गया और बड़े गुस्से में बोली, भैया अगर पालक को अब होश आ गया हो तो 1 किलो दे दो. Thank you very much. Let us close this session here. Thank you.
Now I would request Mr. Lalit Jainji to come and present a memento to Mr. U.K. Chaudhary. Mr. Parveen Duaji to come and present a memento to Mr. Surendra Kathia. Thank you very much. Now I would request Mr. NPS Chawla to come and coordinate.
You see, as per schedule, we have to wind up at 2:30 because lunch is also equally important. But let me assure you, this panel discussion which we have kept will definitely make us that okay, the time is well spent. May I, without taking much time, may I request the secretary to CCI, Ms. Rita Chinnanji, and Ms. Neena Gupta from Intergroup, Intergroup Alliance, Mr. Ashish Chandra, and Dr. Sandeep Prabhakar, please come and share the dais with me. Thanks, Ms. Smita Chinjal, is presently the Secretary of Competition Commission of India and is a very senior civil servant. She is IRS with over 29 years of experience and has held a wide range of positions in the Revenue Department that involved implementation of tax laws, tax-related investigations, framing of tax assessments and judicial representations. And she is MPhil in Defense and Strategic Studies and a law graduate. We welcome you, ma'am, and I request the chairman, NPS Chawla, to kindly come and give a bouquet of flowers as women and for love. We have with us let me tell you, though I don't have a resume, but I can make a resume standing here, a very dynamic lady with us is Neena Gupta, a lawyer by profession, I would say. I feel that the kind of service she is doing into even the CS profession. She joined as a Deputy General Counsel at one point of time to Indigo Airlines, this the entire intergroup group, and then moved as a Group General Counsel to the intergroup group, which is of the Indigo Airlines, and I'm feeling proud that now she is the Executive Director of the intergroup group, a powerful lady who can, I would say, the one of the department, if I say, is the law department, which she has handled, and she has made it to this. Even the, I would say, the managing director, that has also moved from as a group general counsel to the MD of Indigo Airlines. She is also with us just to discuss about the prospects and the impact of the competition on the airline industry. We have Mr. Gamawat here also with us. Mr. Dr. Sanjeev Kamawat, he is also a member of our profession and is a senior vice president with DLF Group and currently looks after the legal and sectoral compliance officers of DLF Redco Group and DLF Holdings. I think if I start reading his, it will again take time for me to read his entire biodata for this. But we as a company secretary always feel proud that our own member has risen to that level and is holding all that positions, and he's you see, a prolific speaker at various of our seminars and at various locations, including at the National Law Institutes and ICSI and ICI. These are the institutes which we are taking it up, and we have our own member. Again, I feel proud about the Ashish. I would say he is like a younger brother would say that when he passed out as a company secretary, he was saying that he joined at one point of time in Singhania, partners. Am I right, Ashish? Right. Now, and then moved to Bombay and held various positions. And today, in the e-commerce sector, if somebody has to name, it is Ashish Chandra. And then now he moved back to Delhi from Bombay and joined as a group general counsel of Snapdeal with us. And I personally requested that he should also come and join us for the panel discussions. May I request, first of all, Deepak Kukreja to kindly come and give a bouquet of flowers to Ashish. May I request Kapil Ji to kindly come and give a bouquet of flowers to Dr. Sanjeev Kumar. I'll request Madam Smita Jindal Ji to chair the session and to moderate the panel discussion. I will be there also to, you see, assist ma'am to ask some questions to this thing which are in my mind, and we can just work it out. And I would say, I personally feel that if we can make this more interactive on those practical aspects which we are facing, be it into the cement industry, be it into the builders association, or how the e-commerce market is making an impact as far as this thing there, how far the issues which are cropping up in the airline industry, which we can just discuss about it, and we can have, and few questions definitely I would love that, okay, though there would be a paucity of time, maybe 3-4 questions from the audience, if you feel, let it be to the So I leave it to you, that okay? Yes.
At the very outset, let me thank the ICSI for giving me this opportunity to be here this afternoon and to chair this session. It is indeed my privilege to be here. I also see the earnestness on the faces of all the audience. I know it's very close to lunch and you must be tired since the morning. But we have such an esteemed panel here, so we cannot lose this opportunity of sharing their views. The topic for this panel is an industry perspective to competition law and compliance. Before I move on to the panelists, may I take just 2 minutes of your time to just share about the Commission's perspective? I know the topic is industry perspective. For the Commission, what is the perspective to competition law? It lies in our objectives. You see, the objectives of the Act, which are laid out in the preamble, are repeated as duties of the Commission in Section 18. So we stand by those duties. And how do we execute them? We execute them through 4 pillars of our Act. The first three pillars are the enforcement functions of the Act, that is, prohibition of any anti-competitive behavior, prohibition of any abuse of dominance, and regulations of combinations. Now, these 3 pillars have been talked about in great detail by the earlier speakers this morning, and I think you all are full of it. I'm not going to dwell on that. The last pillar, which is extremely important, is advocacy. In fact, you all here are here today because of this particular function under our Act. It's mandated under our Act. I think the best advocacy is through our orders. Our orders are available on the websites, and we have remedies in the form of monetary penalties, cease and desist orders. And recently we have even had a new order where we have blacklisted certain people from being members of association. This is a Kerala film case. So that is the reach of this commission. You all know that we have been having advocacy ever since 2002 onwards, because after that there was judicial challenge and our Act, actually our enforcement functions, came about in 2009. Despite that advocacy, you all actually got up and recognized that there is something called the Competition Commission when the newspapers flashed the monetary penalties levied. I mean, it's natural. Of course, that does not in any way undermine the importance of seminars like this. Seminars, workshops, programs are extremely important, and we do hope that our outreach to stakeholders is more through the latter route than the former. But the former is a is something that we are all conscious about. Anyone who's read the orders on the website would know that three sectors, in fact, there are a number of sectors which we receive a lot of information about. But one is the real estate sector. Then there's a lot in the pharma sector, films, media, and now e-commerce is a new sector. Airlines, of course, we've had a number of cases, but we haven't levied any penalties. So these are the panelists here with us today are from these very sectors, and I'm sure they have a very, they'll share a lot of important details with you, and they would really give the industry perspective to this. About the real estate sector, I would want to say, because I want to say a sentence about that, because out of all the informations we receive, I'm not talking about the complaints that we receive. We receive hundreds of complaints, but I'm talking about informations where people actually pay money and bring a case before the commission. We have 135 informations from the real estate sector. I think the figures speak out loud. So without standing in the way, we have this esteemed panel here. I think we always start with ladies first. So Nida, I'll ask you to start off.
It's a lot of responsibility on me to try and keep up to that introduction. So thank you all for calling me here. And it was an extremely busy time for me for the last 1 week. So I'll be very honest and confess that I was not able to prepare for this session, something that I don't like to do. So I'll keep it very, very generalistic and high level. And just one correction in my introduction is that, first of all, I work for the parent company of Indigo, which is Interglobe Enterprises, and I'm not the MD of Indigo. Okay. So that correction was really necessary because I think there's a lot of information on the press and I don't want somebody to going out and saying, okay, Satvinder didn't even know who he called. Yes, the earlier general counsel of Interglobe did move as the president and CEO of Indigo. So I think I'd like to summarize, I think I'd like to begin with, you know, the I read in the newspaper reports as of August 2015, where the Honorable Chairperson, Mr. Chokshi Chawla himself said that capping the fares in the airline industry would be anti-competitive and will not be in the spirit of why this act was made. And he went on to say that the pricing would be determined by the market forces and the Competition Commission is not here to gain popularity. So I think that those words of his, I think, are really welcomed by the aviation industry. We have very high esteem for the members of the commission, who I think do understand the industry and its challenges. But you know, I just would like to just say 4 points, and I'm only talking about the presumption on cartelization in the aviation industry. I'm not going to go into other things because I don't think there has been as many cases on that. The maximum number of cases have come on predatory pricing, cartelization, and collusive behavior regarding pricing. I think there has been only one much talked about combination, the Jet Etihad deal, which anyway went through the process after whole rounds of issues around it. So I think, considering the paucity of time, I'll just give my perspective on the presumption of cartelization or collusive behavior as to pricing in the aviation sector. So the first thing, the one of the most popular example that I always give when there is a presumption of cartelization is that in 1991, when I first traveled by an airline, Air India, from Delhi to Mumbai with my father, we had to make a choice that can we fly to and fro, can we fly one way. The ticket price was one way 10,000 rupees. So my father decided, since the interview that I was going for was very important, he said, let's take the flight. And while coming back, we took the Rajdhani Express in order to save money. So 25 years ago, one way Delhi-Bombay used to cost 10,000 rupees. Now sitting here in 2015, I can actually go and come back from Bombay in less than 10,000 rupees at times, and sometimes and 20,000 rupees. So considering the value of money, there is something that is going right in the aviation sector, that the fares have continued to decline, or the aviation sector today is making it very affordable for people who considered airlines as a luxury travel. That is one thing. The second thing I'd like, so the, another point that I want to make in the defense of the presumption on cartelization is, and that's more of an educative process, and you know, as ma'am herself said, that our orders are the best example of that advocacy. So if you look at the three orders that the CCI has passed between 09 to 12 on the presumption of cartelization, I think the order speaks to itself that the dynamic nature of the pricing in an airline is what that prevails. The market forces determine pricing. You know, the pricing depends on the time that you book the flight or the demand and supply. Even today, if I was to book a flight in between December 22nd to 1st of January, I think the fare that I will get on any particular flight from, let's say, Delhi Goa would not be less than 20,000 rupees. But if the same flight, if I was to book in the first week of December, the price would be far less than that. So the airline are pricing ahead because they position it based on the capacity and the demand and the supply during that point in time. So I think that sort of educative process, and I think the consumer is quite savvy now to know when to book a flight. If you are in an emergency situation, you may end up paying a lot more because that is the last two seats that are available, because of which, you know, you have to pay more, and that will happen across the airlines. So I think those orders speaks to itself, and while there's a recent inquiry based on I think some movement again on cartelization, but I'm sure that the airlines will submit what they have to, and hopefully we'll be able to prove that the cartelization was only in presumption. The third thing that I want to really you know, also talk about is the transparency of pricing that is available in the public domain. Rule 134 of Aircraft Act itself tells us that in the beginning of the month, I am supposed to publish my tariffs. So I think the competition gets to know the tariffs in the beginning of the month. And every time I change my tariffs from the range during any period of the month, I'm supposed to notify that, and that is published on the net. So with this sort of information that is available, I think the competition would behave and move towards a similar sort of pricing, and I think that has been proved in the various investigations of CCI. And the last, but not the least, on a lighter way, I think we always say in the office that whenever you find a room full of people, you find a room full of aviation experts. And they say that the worst kind of expert is actually the politician, because he travels a lot, and that's why aviation continues to be regulated. But thankfully, the pricing is deregulated, and the commission recognizes that, and I think the commission is very cognizant of the fact that the market forces do govern the pricing. So I think that's my submission on the presumption of cartelization. Thank you.
Yeah. I think it's more of a panel discussion. Yes, you have given your little perspective of this thing. May I ask one question for this thing?
Yes, please.
You see, we have all heard about the Jet Etihad deal. Yes. Like it was when CCI approved it, it was one of the very hotly debated approval, I would say. How do you consider that approval and the combination of Jet Etihad has impacted the airline industry, if I just put it?
So officially, I'm not authorized to speak on that.
No, I'm just giving the industry perspective.
Okay. So I think the Jet Etihad combination, being the first in the aviation industry, and also at a time when the recent change in the regulation had happened, that foreign airlines were suddenly allowed to invest, which was, I think, resisted by some of the existing airlines at that time, became a very controversial combination. But I think CCI, obviously after a whole, it was a dissenting order, I remember, and it was a majority ruling which allowed the combination. And having some insight into it and knowing fully well how code shares and investments finally work, I think we'll have to give it some time to Jatatihar to actually stabilize and see how the efficiencies have now come in. But personally, and I think from an industry perspective, I think such combinations are welcome. And the industry is really requires funding and expertise and the ability to thrive. And I think that such type of combinations will actually facilitate the thriving of the aviation industry. Having said that, I think the players are cognizant of their responsibilities on not indulging in anti-competitive behavior when they make such combinations. And I think so far it has not happened in the Jatatihar. And I think the commission is really watching and doing a tremendous job on that.
I have one question. It's regarding no-show in case, you know, by passenger misses a flight because of any reason.
Yes, sir.
Now what happens is the airline forfeits the entire fare from the consumer.
Yes,
how justified is it? And at the same time, that fee may be auctioned to another passenger for a higher price. In America, something different happens. If there is too much traffic, they ask for volunteers. And they say that we will give you $1,000, $2,000, if you volunteer not to travel by this particular flight. So how is it known that in India, India is different?
So I think I won't give you an answer that you will like. I think this is governed by our conditions of carriage, which are known to you in advance. And I think CCI has looked into this aspect, where I think at least our airline was accused of abuse of dominant position and made its finding that that was not the case. I think I can only say that I know that that's one of the complaints that we receive very often when there's a no-show, but I think airlines have to, the reason that we are able to deliver on time and we are able to deliver the efficiency for the rest of the passengers is because of strict rules like this which we adhere to. But I know that the consumer would not like losing money when it's a no-show. But I guess it's a cash 22 situation both for the airline and the passenger. And I don't have a better proposal for you, but I'm sure over time we'll figure this out as to how to keep our consumers happy in situations like this.
Friends, though I leave it to the chair to you see moderate this thing, but my request is that okay, if we can have the question answers from the audience, maybe let first the panelists give their perspective and then you can ask the questions.
So I must mention out of the 19, I think, inquiries, 18 of the order, you know.
Yeah, 19 when you speak of parties, yes. But in orders it's much less. But so she really caught me on when we're talking about advocacy through orders. But thanks, Nina, that was a very nice industry perspective. You put it all together. So, Sanjeev, so since you have order against DLM, and yours is the industry which is really, we get a lot of cases, and most of them we have to close down under 26.2, that is at the prima facie stage itself, because we are tied down with establishing dominance. So your views.
Good afternoon, friends. Absolutely my privilege to be here. First, of course, I work with DLF, so I would be restraining myself in terms of giving any views which are pertaining to DLF. So whatever views I would be expressing, they would be my personal views in my working with different industries. Real estate industry is one industry. I worked in automobile industry also, other industries as well. So I would be giving broadly my views about the industry perspective. And industries are most all kinds of industries, including real estate industry. Ma'am, you touched very important important subject when we started the conversation, and the conversation was what was the real objective of this law, and that was enshrined in the, as far as the objectives of the law is concerned, and that objective was to promote education. I know for sure that when in 2002 this act came, I was part of various seminars and conferences, and I would say that the whole industry was very excited about this legislation. The thought which was going on in the industry's mind is that this would pervade to all walks of life and it would impact the lives of almost everyone as far as the way in which the business is getting conducted is concerned. But then you also tells a very important part, that today the recognition is because of monetary penalties. And at times people talk about this, that whether this competition commission is a penalty commission, because this is a mindset issue. Basically, we are making popularize the institution by imposing penalties and all of that. So I think broadly, the way in which I would be thinking about, and if I want to give an industry perspective in a very brief words, I would say that yes, objective was absolutely fine. Industry is still excited about the Competition Act and the enforcement mechanism. I also think that 5 years is too limited a duration to assess the performance of an institution. But then if somebody asked me that whether this institution is established, I would say that yes, this institution is established today. And how this institution is established? Because of the very fact that the penalty institution, when it becomes a penalty institution, it has got that kind of recognition and apprehension in the minds of the people. But then, does industry want this legislation? Answer is yes. I would say that, for example, if I mention the case of like Hiranandani's case, where you say that the exclusive arrangements cannot happen. Now, I think that the industry also wants the Competition Commission to take those issues where the government, not in their sovereign functions, but in non-sovereign functions, they are having exclusive arrangements. You would be surprised to know that I have seen some of the bylaws, for example, the advertisement bylaws of various states. There, the government says they would be having an arrangement with only one party for advertisement of the whole city. Now, these are all anti-competitive kind of arrangements, and which the government is doing. I think that those actions are required. Industry wants this, because this is all impacting the whole industry. As a common citizen also, I can give some perspective that yes, for example, if I ask you one basic question, that can you change your newspaper vendor? And I give this example normally, that can you change your newspaper vendor? The answer is that you can't change your newspaper vendor. Is it anti-competitive? Answer is anti-competitive. And can you do something about it? Answer is no, you cannot do something about it. The moment you change it, from the next day onwards, you will not get your newspapers. Now, these are the issues where I think actions need to be taken so that it impacts the life of the common people, and then that kind of awareness about this legislation, I think that is more important rather than getting a recognition by imposing penalties. Ma'am, you touched a very important subject, 135 information on real estate sector. Now I believe, and it gives me a thought, that whether these 135 informations for initiating the investigations are because you have imposed heavy penalties to the real estate developers? Perhaps answer lies there. Now, I think these are some of the issues I think we need to think about. And it's just brief perspective. I'm open for discussion on any of these subjects.
So, I would say, my friend is really pointing out this thing is, I think the point which you are making it is, how far you feel that, okay, the CCA should be proactive in, you see, making the competition, as the advocacy on the competition or promote competition. That's a one issue which I'm just making it. And I also heard that maybe CREDAI or the Builders Association, you see, they filed a case against the cement. Because if I say the real estate industry and the cement industry, both are, you see, blended, because that is there. So those are the issues where I would say how far the case against the cement, Builders Cements Association would benefit the real estate agents. How far the CCI should take the proactive measures. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, very difficult to give a comment as far as that specific issue is concerned. But largely, I would say that as far as the organized industry is concerned, CCI has been fairly successful in terms of initiating actions in almost all kinds of industries. Whether that be media, for example, a relationship between distributors, producers, and exhibitors, CCI has been absolutely successful in terms of creating that level of awareness. And I would say that there they have restrained themselves in terms of imposition of penalties also. There were, you know, a few lakhs and something, but then the masses has gone. Similarly, I would say even in the cement industry's case, I think that CCI has been successful, you know, in terms of creating that level of awareness. Now, if you talk about using CCI as a tool to take advantage of your business interest, I think that that would be inappropriate in terms of the enforcement of this law and in terms of awareness of this law. And unfortunately, I agree with that view, that unfortunately, this is what happens in the industry. Now, CCI is being used as a tool to balance out or to settle your scores or to agree to a certain kind of arrangement. I think that their CCI needs to create that level of awareness so that people can restrain themselves, refrain themselves in terms of having those kind of arrangements or those kinds of you know, litigations. Certain views can always be expressed, like automobile industry. At times I wonder, of course, that you know, the immediate thought would be allowing other, you know, the service providers to work on your vehicle. That is fine. But then in a product which is highly technical, a product which is governed under the Motor Vehicles Act, a product which has some safety standard, a product which can impact if that is not run properly or not fitted properly, can have a you know, run the risk of damaging people. Now they are in that kind of scenario, having those kind of judgments where we say that, you know, you cannot have the exclusive arrangements as far as the automobile service providers are concerned. I think that that would be a challenge, and I don't know what would happen in the times to come in terms of these judgments. But then, yes, awareness point of view, it helps. But I think that there are certain technical issues also which need to be addressed in due course of time.
So just before I pass on to Mr. Lalit, about penalties, you know, being the CCI being a penalty commission, I just want to say, no, that's not the thing. Penalties is just one of the remedies available for us. Now it's a penalty that you all stands it up to, you know. But otherwise, it's not a revenue collecting organization. The objective is laid out in our preamble. It is to regulate the market and for the benefit of market participants, for the benefits of industries and market other industries in that sector. So definitely, the 135 information that you mentioned, that is it because of the penalties? I would rather want to believe that it is because the sector is yelling out for a regulator. So I know some of the orders that have been passed by the commission. The commission has also given an advisory that it needs to be a real estate regulator. So with that, we move on to Ashish. Ashish is going to talk to us about the e-sector, which is the most in thing these days, attracting a lot of FDI also. So let's hear Ashish.
Congratulate on this joint effort to spread the awareness about competition law and the compliance. I would start with some sort of anecdote. I mean, today being a Saturday, being a weekend, I normally work, as you know, everybody works like 18 hours in a day. So today is the only day where I spend time with my family. So today I had to actually enter into a big fight with my wife to come over here. But how I surprised her, and how I have made her feel happy that all my grocery shopping was done when Satvinder was opening his remark on the day, thanks to some fanciful apps. So, and I have also fixed the time that when that grocery guy will actually come to my house in Gurgaon to come and deliver. I have booked a movie ticket for my wife and my son. We are going out to watch some fancy movie in the evening. And I have also booked a dinner for my family. So I think I'm all set and can enjoy talking to you a lot. So that's the benefit of the e-sector and the e-commerce, just from a consumer perspective. Now, if I look back and see this theme of this conference, is that competition law and compliance, a growth enabler. I think I would actually focus again on the last three words, a growth enabler. And Smita ma'am, let me tell you that e-commerce industry owe a big thanks to CCI. Because I think the way CCI has understood the requirement and intricacies of this industry, and the way CCI has supported us against the various adversaries, various information stroke complaints which were being filed. And I think a very reasoned and very thorough orders have been given by CCI. That's why I'm sure that 90% people in this room would have made some buying in this week, either over Snapdeal, Flipkart, Amazon, or any other website. And I'll tell you what are those two very critical orders of CCI, which has actually helped us to grow, you know, and have a good Diwali for everybody. The first order was, and the first case was that there was a brand manufacturer into some sort of you know, kitchen kind of appliances, and so you know, they were actually forcing one of the e-commerce website, I won't name them, that they should allow the sale of their products on the e-commerce website not below a particular threshold. As we know, most of the e-commerce websites are themselves not the sellers, you know, they're the marketplaces, they allow other sellers to list and sell the products. But they said that, okay, if you allow sellers to sell below a particular price, then I'm going to, you know, put some kind of warning in the newspaper that if you buy my products on these websites, I will not honor warranties, they are promoting counterfeits. And they actually used to tell the people that if you buy, they were not honoring your warranties and all stuff like that. So one particular e-commerce website went before CCI because they felt that this is quite unfair. And CCI in its wisdom has held that you know, there exists a prima facie case that the brand owner is engaging in resale price maintenance, which is prohibited under the competition law. That order sent the right message to the industry, and that is why, you know, we are enjoying some good prices on the e-commerce website. There can be a question whether these are predatory. I know Satvinder has a question for me on that. I will answer that. But you know, you are enjoying good prices, you are enjoying variety of goods, you are sitting over here and buying. That was order number one. The order number two, which was that various people went to CCI by saying that, you know, look, all these sites enter into exclusive arrangement. Let's say Xiaomi phone is available only on a particular website, or Redmi phone is available, OnePlus One phone, and Google Nexus and all. So these phones are not available in the brick and mortar stores. So, you know, this is anti-competitive, we will be out of the business. And I must confess, you know, the farsightedness, the in-depth of understanding of CCI into the matter when they were defining the relevant market. Very beautifully they said that, look, it's not a brand market. It's not that, you know, you want to buy a Xiaomi phone which is only available on a particular website, not other website. It's not a Xiaomi phone which is a product market. It is the technical specification, a 5-inch phone with so-and-so megapixel camera, with so-and-so 4G, 2G, stuff like that. And you have alternative available in the e-commerce, your other competitors, as well as in the brick and mortar website. That's why you see most of the websites go for exclusive launches, because that give platform for new brands to test the Indian market at a good price. So a big thank you from the industry to CCI, because you're actually help industry to grow. And I take a leaf out of the statement made by Sri Ashok Chawla, is that, you know, these are disruptive technology. This is going to happen. And I would say in India, this is not a disruptive technology. This technology or this business model has disrupted the Western countries about 20 years back. I mean, I'm now in Snapdeal. I used to work for eBay when eBay entered into India after acquiring Bazi. I have seen that it's not a new phenomenon in India. I mean, it's long back and in US. But this change is going to happen. iTunes and your mobile downloads of music has completely disrupted your cassettes and your CDs and all stuff like that. E-commerce is going to disrupt. That's how the world will actually progress, right? And I think the ecosystem has to participate in the new way of conducting business, rather than an old economy thought thinking to try to kill this industry. I'll sign off with one statement which will give you that what kind of stress is happening between the online and offline industry. And I know Satvinder another has, you know, one more question for me on that. About 2 months back, I read one article in ET Panache. I mean, that's a supplementary which comes with the Economic Times. And the statement was made by the founders of one of the hotels aggregator, right, akin to Airbnb. So he made a very bold statement. He said that, you know, I have become so big in the last 6-7 months. The biggest threat I have is that I get live threats from my offline competitors. So I think if anybody tried to stop the growth of disruptive technology, I think that itself is anti-competitive, not the activities done by disruptive technologies are anti-competitive. So that's what I wanted to just say. Yeah.
Outside and I said, Ashish, I have 2-3 questions for you. One is on the predatory pricing. But I think the issue which was coming to my mind, when you see, when I am representing the venture capitalists, I am representing the others, is that the money which is coming in India through the venture capitalist, is it supposed that, okay, I'm just taking this radio caps, you name this thing, which the funding which is coming to this thing, is it the way that, okay, you curb the market, reduce the prices, maybe you name Ola caps, you may any radio caps for this thing, or for that pricing methodology which is being adopted just to take the market, how far it is good as an industry? That is the one issue which was coming to my mind on the predatory pricing. That is where I was thinking that I should touch about the role of the venture funds.
Okay.
And then taking it up from this.
So
that I will put the other question is, okay, when you touch the issue of the brick and mortars, that is it that now which you feel that e-commerce is going to be only mainly the retail market? What is the relevant market when we discussed about that concept and other things? What is the future of the retail in India, particularly when this Snap deal is coming, particularly the Flipkart is coming, all these things? How do you evaluate the retail market in times to come for that? There are two questions I thought that I must ask you for.
Let me answer your second question first. If I have the benefit to know that what's the future of e-commerce market, I am sure that SoftBank will write a $1 billion check to me. Unfortunately, I don't know, and hence I'm not the unicorn of. But to come back to your first question, venture capital firms are extremely sophisticated, sir. Extremely sophisticated. They are not here to lose money, because everybody who invests, they are here to make money. Whether they make money in 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, it's a cycle of a particular business, right? My question to everybody is that, why is there that foreign venture capitalists and foreign funds are writing $1 billion checks or $100 billion check? Why can't the Indian HNIs, Indian big corporate house, write a $100 million check or a $500 million check to a school dropout, right? Because they don't write. And we note that there is some problem which these e-commerce company, high technology company are solving. Fortunately, in the Western world, these highly sophisticated venture capitalists, they have seen that with their investment, how the world has changed, how the day-to-day problem of the people have got solved, and people have changed their habit of buying or doing their activities. Now, they have seen this. They have belief in the Indian entrepreneur. They are writing $500 million checks. But unfortunately, I mean, I haven't seen any good Indian still house writing more than $20 million check. That's point number one. Point number two, the money which has come or which comes doesn't go in predatory pricing or discounting. Let me give you an example. If you have to go to Vijay Sales or a Croma or any other your offline retail store, you are greeted with a banner that please come inside. If you buy anything using your HDFC, ICICI bank credit card, I give you an extra 5% cash back or an extra 10% off, right? That's your marketing strategy to attract the people, footfalls into your store, right? Similarly, in this fierce competitive market, those who have the maximum eyeballs would generate the maximum GMV, and those who can generate the maximum GMV will also get profitability. Now, it's a business model. You use various things. I mean, I may choose that I may spend billions of dollars to all the Bollywood and Hollywood stars and will say that you come and song and dance for me. that will give me good eyeballs. Or I may say that for me, consumer is the king. I want to attract the consumer. I want to incentivize him that please come to my website, buy some product, I give you additional freebies. Am I linking that freebie only to one particular phone? I say that you come, you buy anything, you buy any damn thing, you know, you will get 1,000 rupees off, right? So it's not about a discounting or a predatory pricing. Last point on this, let me tell you, 75% of the money which is coming in India is not going into discounting. Discounting is a bad word. It's going to solve the day-to-day problem of the retail market in India. You know where the amount are invested? In order to fix the problem of supply chain. You know where the amount is going to be invested? To make sure that the technology is safe and sound so that people are easy. More than 60% of the trades are happening on all the three big websites from tier 2 to tier 3 cities. If we don't solve this problem, these people will not be able to get the benefit of retail. The iPhone 6 can only be available in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore and all on day one. But we make sure that iPhone 6 is available in a tier 2 or a tier 3 city where people have capacity to pay but they don't have the means to buy. So 75%, rough estimate, don't quote me, is going to solve the technological and infrastructure problem to create a good system for a sustainable e-commerce site. E-commerce is here to stay. It's not a 2000 bubble where transactions were not happening. Today transactions are happening. People are opening up their wallet. People are making the payment. I think it is only those entities which invest in right technology, have the right processes, will survive. The offline and the online industry will coexist. So there I want to end.
Thanks, Ashish, but you skirted the question on predatory pricing. Is it just the discounts? So you're committing that these aren't predatory pricing?
These are, okay, so these are not discount, these are not predatory pricing. As I gave example that if you go to Croma and you know, if you want to buy something, you have been greeted by HDFC Bank that if you buy something, I will, you know, I will offer you 10% cash back. Is that a predatory pricing? Croma can have that, okay, now if you come and buy something from my site, I will give you a gift voucher so that you can come back again. So these are, the word marketing has changed its entire dynamics from a traditional style of marketing to a new style of marketing. It's about customer retention. It's about customer incentivization. There are various means. I can stop doing all this kind of incentivization and can pay to all the Bollywood stars to you know, dance for me. I'll say that I will not pay that. I will go and greet my customers.
So today our consumer stands advantaged. Will this advantage carry on in the future once they are hooked on to e-commerce?
I will give you one example, madam. I shifted from Bombay to Delhi last year in the month of September and my family continued there for 6 months. I had to buy a personal laptop over here and I wanted to buy a Mac because I'm a Mac user. So I browsed through all the website. You know, I was the best price which I was basically getting was around 55,000 rupees. I went to a Mac authorized dealer in GK1 M Block market, not in Chowdhury Bazaar or something like that. In a premium market, I was able to buy the Mac without showing him the price which was available on Snapdeal, Flipkart and all, exactly at the same price, right? When my family moved into Gurgaon, I had to buy a water filter, something like that. The price at which I bought at Croma was exactly the same price, maybe you know 100 rupees here and there, on all the e-commerce website. So I don't know, I mean, I think there's a price parity already. What e-commerce is trying to do is that it is trying to make sure that the offline retailers make a reasonable margin. It has dented the real estate industry. As you said, there is no regulator, so real estate industry, shopping mall, for charging exorbitant rents, right? Now, because they don't have any kind of offline retailer who are making good margins, the rentals are coming down. So it is actually bringing the efficiency in the entire ecosystem. That's my view. There could be interpretation, predatory pricing. I don't think it's a predatory pricing because technically, legally, I don't control the sale price of that product.
Okay. Thanks a lot, but I think the audience is itching for questions. I think you...
need to be changed, then you know the
most of the companies, they give informants within 2 days, and if you don't inform them, we have no liability. And in any case, return money never comes. So, whereas, you know, in America, there is a return policy of 90 days. Even if the product has been used, you go to the store, return it, and you get instant credit to your card. So how do you explain
that? So as what Nina said about that every business and a company has its own policy to run the business. In US, maybe that's a market trend that people are used to of a 90-day, no question asked, use and throw kind of a return policy. India is a different country. Every business would have its own ways and means to business. Having said that, if you have got a defective product, most of the websites have a good return your own policy. But in case it is not being fulfilled, then you can always go to the consumer court. As far as payment goes, most of the payments, when you are making the payment online, that money is not coming into the bank account of the e-commerce company. That money is going into a nodal bank account which operates under appropriate RBI guidelines. As far as the COD payment is concerned, if you don't get your money back, then I think the e-commerce company loses you as a customer. Second, you have a fantastic case to file and file an FIR against the company. I don't think company would ever do that. Yeah, but I think for the companies who are good and mature company, it's not about legal process. I think they would hate to lose any customer. If you get lost, if you don't come back, if you are not happy with a particular company, downline, 1,000 people will not be happy, because that's how your marketing things work, that if you're not happy, you will influence at least 1,000 people. So I think it's only maybe because of some internal frauds, maybe because of some companies which are not so honest, you may face some problem. But ordinarily, people should not face any problem. If you face problem, I think all the big companies do have very strong return policy, customer care policies and all. We get all these complaints on a daily basis, but I think our strong policies take care of that.
Sir,
you can go to my website. We have SLAs over there.
I know that, okay, because we are getting delayed for lunch. That is more important than having even on this discussion, the way I feel that, okay. But may I request everyone that, okay, just bear with us for 2-3 minutes. I'll request the chairperson to kindly wrap up with the summing remarks, and then I will propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you for the chairperson of the panel. That you can get the audience. Half the audience has walked up towards lunch, so let me wrap this up. It seems that it was an extremely interesting session. We had the industry views from 3 eminent persons. My thanks to you for having sat through it, and this being the last session. So thank you very much.
So, friends, before I propose a vote of thanks, I got a message. We have a session on the annual filing where the eminent persons, Mr. KMS Narayanan, who is the dealing with the policy issues from in the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, he is coming. Mr. Ankit Jain and Mr. Bhaskar from Infosys are already here. It is immediately post lunch. There would be about 2.5-3 hour session. It will be taken in depth on the various issues with respect to AOC-4, FDT-7 and XBRL. So I'll request each and every member to be there in the post lunch session and to discuss. I think everybody will agree the kind of we had the panel discussion on the issues and the perspective to the competition law. I thank Madam Samita and the other panelists for acceding to our request to be here. May I request Vidhi to kindly come and give a memento to Madam Samita ji on behalf of the institute. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for being here and gracing the occasion for this.
Maybe I'll also request to grace us by giving present momentum to Nina also. May I request Hardev Singh to kindly come and give a mantle to Mr. Ashish. May I request NPS to kindly come handy and give a mantle to your dear friend and my in any case. Thanks. Thank you so much. It was really a wonderful session. Thanks to all the panelists. May I request everybody to kindly join for a lecture.